Hey guys, we're shipping in. So I think that there are just all these ways that the see where that Vietnam impacts and touches us. And I'm going to not make my story long, but without Vietnam, I would have been an ambassador somewhere by now, right? Because I was in the Peace Corps in Turkey in 65 to 67. I came back and I passed the written test for the Foreign Service, and I did my interview. And in the interview, they said, well, your first post is going to be Vietnam. And I said, well, and I'd also been offered a job on the Peace Corps staff. And I said, I'm not ready to deal with this war business. I went into the peacemaking business. So I went with the Peace Corps. And the lady very nicely said, you come back and see us in 3 years. And you don't have to take the written test again. Okay, I'll go do that. And all this stuff will be over. And I'll come back in 3 years and go into the state. But well, a couple years later, I'm back in Turkey. And Vietnam is weighing over Turkey like it is weighing over everybody else. And when I came back to the States, and Judy and I were in Washington, D.C., and it was not going to be there. I wasn't going to go into the State Department in 1971. So we came to Wallowa County, like a lot of people. And this is another thing that I can tell you, because I did a little research at the time. The 70s, if you'll remember, was the back to the land movement. It was the what was it called? The farm, the one in Tennessee, and all these communes, and everybody was getting away from the riots that had happened in the 60s and the war, and they went to rural areas, and that's one of the things that got us here. So anyway, it certainly impacted my life and those around me. So with that, Angie, do you want to start? No?
Maisie, would you start?
Okay. Or let's soften our way into this. You can do two parts. Tell us about you, or Elaine, tell us about, give a little overview of the 1969, and then go to Nancy's story. Okay. Does that make sense?
That's good.
Okay.
Elaine and I went to the Chieftain, got out there big 1969, because that was basically when Tim O'Brien was in combat. And Elaine took pictures, we drew them up. One thing that stood out for me is that there were 181 service people from this county in 1969, 181. That's 3% of the general population. I couldn't find an estimate of what the 18 to 25, what percentage that would have been. They range from their Navy, Marines, Green Berets, their citations, their injuries, their just a whole lot of information. And I haven't lived in the county long enough to know a lot of the people, but I recognize some of the names that were involved. The thing that stands out is the Roberts family, four siblings in uniform in 1969. And Nancy and I are going to town. So anyway, but this is not just, we want this as a sharing. Nancy's going to get up. And then if you have, to me, war is war. Yes, there are differences in each one. But they're always the people that are left at home. And so it doesn't matter if it was the Korean War, World War II, Iraq, Afghanistan, any of these. If you were a mother, a brother, a sister, girlfriend, I had classmates that I wrote to, any of that that you would like to share with us, we would really like to hear where you were in 69 and how this particular war, or any war, affected you. So Nancy.
Well, when I was
And I think it used to be, I think my age has something to do with it. But,
Rich is just like you. Cry on
the floor. And me too.
I said, this is public.
I used to be a real tough cookie. And back in 69, it was really tough. In 65, when I graduated high school, I had big plans for getting married. And my husband and I, or my husband-to-be and I made plans. And 3 weeks before our wedding date, my husband was drafted. But fortunately, the minister that was going to marry us would have none of that. He wanted to marry us in the church that we wanted to be married in, and he heard that our plans were being possibly going to be changed, and so he called us up and he says, when you come into my office, he says, I'm on the draft board here locally, and I know there's maybe one more space in the National Guard. And if Bill travels out to the Grand, possibly he can get in the Guard. And so he did, and he did get into the Guard. And so fortunately, my husband became a member of the National Guard. The downside to that is it didn't mean he could shirk any duties. He still had to go into the National Guard. And our honeymoon was one day. Well, we got married on a Saturday night, and went as far as the Grand, and the next day was a guard meeting in the Grand. But it worked out fine. We didn't have any more than $75 to spend on a honeymoon anyway. And then anyway, my older brother was one of our ushers, and his girlfriend at the time, who was still his wife, was one of her bridesmaids. And life went on, and a year later they were married. And Chuck's story is really unique in that he hasn't let his disability or his injury in Vietnam slow him down one bit. In fact, he's probably been more successful than a lot of people that have not had a disability, which I'm very proud of. I brought an article that I'm going to read some excerpts from that people from Wallowa County maybe did not see, because it wasn't in the Chieftain. It was written by a person from the East Oregonian in 1986. And they interviewed my brother, and it pretty much tells what kind of a person he is and why he's been so successful. His name is Charles, but he never went by that. He always went by Chuck, and that more adequately fit him. And the headline read, I can do almost anything, and paralyzed vet rejects bitterness. He's never been bitter about his injury, and he made that very clear from the first time we were able to see him after he came home from Vietnam. I'll kind of give you a little preface of how we all heard about his injury. Chuck was injured in Vietnam, of course. He was the only one in his platoon that was injured that night. And it took probably more than a week before we heard about his injury. And once he was injured, he was medevaced out of there on one of what they call the McHueys. And once he was stabilized and able to travel from Vietnam, they sent him to Japan to be stabilized further before he could be shipped out to the States. And he was in Japan before we heard that he had even been injured. And when I heard about it, my husband and I were living in Pendleton, and he was
first little girl, and I was pregnant with the second one. And of course, at that time, you didn't know whether you had a boy or a girl, but it doesn't matter. But I was a little over 7 months pregnant with her. And my mom called, and she said, "Nancy, is Bill at home?" Because, of course, we both worked while he was going to school. That was the only way to survive. At that time, I made one small can of tuna fish last 3 days. My third day was just kind of the smell of it. It wasn't any meat. But it worked. But anyway, Bill and I both worked evenings. When he wasn't working one evening, I was working. And some of you know where the Dairy Queen is in Pendleton. Well, there was a Dairy Queen house that we lived in, and we managed the Dairy Queen. And I ran a shift, and Bill did all the maintenance work on the Dairy Queen and the lot. And he also worked at a seed, feed and seed over there to help him get through college. And so our families never really knew who was home and who wasn't. And that particular evening, we were both at home. And Mom asked me if Bill was home. And I said, "Yeah, he is." And she says, "Well, I have something to tell you." And she said, "Your brother's been shot, and he's not in very good shape." And she says, "I don't know very much now, but he's still in Japan." And she said, "They told us that we would find out more in a few days. And Pam doesn't know any more than we do. But as soon as we know more and know when he'll be shipped back to the United States, we'll let you know." So it was just kind of a waiting game. And as soon as we knew when he was going to be shipped back, we were told that he was going to be sent to Fort Lewis in Washington. And as soon as Chuck was able to see visitors, we were going to be allowed to go visit him. And that was probably the hardest part of the whole thing, because when you go to Fort Madigan, or you go to Fort Lewis and go to Madigan General, to a unit that the whole ward was filled with casualties of the war, you saw everything. And when those young men came back from Vietnam, it was nothing like you would ever have seen before in your life. My brother had lost probably 100 pounds. We practically had to be introduced to him because he didn't look anything like what he looked like when he left. He not only had lost so much weight, but he had jungle rot all over his body, which was probably, I had never seen anything like that. I had never seen people with amputated arms, amputated legs, bandages all over their body. Some of them obviously had lost eyes, ears, parts of their body, and it was all very visible that they would never be the same again. And my brother looked pretty good, other than losing so much weight, because he had been shot and his legs had not been amputated. But and we none of us knew at that time for sure that he was paralyzed and would never walk again. And we couldn't visit for very long. We couldn't stay for very long because he was probably in a ward of at least 50 other young men that had been injured. And most of them probably had been injured worse than he had. So we had very limited visiting time. There were four of us, my husband and myself and my parents. And Pam had been there, and she could, he was there at adding it, which was, it made us all feel better that she was going to be there with him. And we knew that he was going to be transferred down to Long Beach for further help to get more extensive help with recovery. But that initial visit at Fort Lewis was probably the most painful, and I've never forgotten how bad he looked. But one thing I will never forget is he made it very clear that regardless of the outcome of his injuries, he would not allow any of us, or any of his family, or any of his friends to feel sorry for him. If he didn't feel sorry for himself, and he didn't want anyone to show any sympathy towards him, you wouldn't allow it. And he made us all promise that we wouldn't. And it's been pretty evident through his life that he hasn't allowed it. And he's gone on with his life as if the only thing different about him is he's in a wheelchair. I want to read a few of the things in this article. And there's been some really funny things that have happened to him over his lifetime. I'm going to share with you too, because people have no idea what stupid things people have said to him over his lifetime that he's shared, and he chuckles about it. This article is really an insight to the way Chuck thinks, and he hasn't changed his thinking. He's if you've ever met Chuck and know him at all, he's a pretty straight shooter. To give you guys a little more background on our family, we were. Our dad was a contractor until he lost his shirt, basically. He loaned too much, built too many houses and didn't get paid for it. And then he went to work for my grandfather on our grandfather's ranch, which was Litch Ranch, which is now the Buffalo Ranch out in Aldersville. And I live probably, Gilman bought a place less than a couple miles from it, and lived there for 38 years. But anyway, we were farm kids, and I had three brothers and myself, so I didn't get to do a whole lot of the farm work, but anyway. This is a part of the article. Although it's the day set aside to honor men like Chuck Wilcox, the Vietnam veteran doesn't consider Veterans Day a special time for him. I'm patriotic, but I'm no flag waver, which isn't really true. He waves a flag quite a bit. He says simply, he's also no activist, even though Vietnam left him unable to walk. Wilcox caught three bullets from an AK assault rifle while on night patrol in an area called Angelding near the Cambodian border. Two of the hits were minor flesh wounds in the back, but the third hit the platoon leader in a rib on his right side under the arm and followed the rib around the back and through the spinal cord before glanced off, stopping a quarter of an inch from a heart. Medevacs, helicopters, were in the air before I was ever injured. There was a lot of action in the air that night, Wilcox, then Sergeant, remembers. But he was the only one in his platoon to be hit that night. The rest of the company secured the landing zone, and it was probably 10 minutes at the most before the chopper landed. Conscious through the hours that followed, Wilcox remembers being examined at a field hospital where doctors discovered a collapsed lung. He was moved to an evac hospital to join an assembly line for surgery. Barely conscious during the following week, He remembers little before arriving in Japan. And in my memory, I when I was thinking about talking, I was thinking, I thought you got to go to Hawaii. it was Japan, where he spent 30 days recuperating. It was there 30 days before he was, you know, well enough to be flown to the States. It was there that he first contacted his wife, Pam, and his parents, Lewis and Bonnie Wilcox of Enterprise. He was coming home. As soon as he was strong enough to endure the flight, he was shipped back to the States. He stayed 2 days at Travis Air Force Base north of San Francisco and was then flown to Madison Army Hospital in Fort Lewis near Tacoma, Washington. He called from Travis for his wife to meet him at Fort Lewis. I was in an ambulance on my way from the airport to the hospital when I saw my wife on the street corner. He says Wilcox. I hollered at the driver, "Hey, that's my wife standing over there." He stopped and let her in to ride to the hospital. After a week at Madigan, the doctors told him his injuries were permanent. That was hard for him to swallow. He spent 4 months in Tacoma again, regaining his health. While he worked in rehabilitation, his wife worked as a nurse in another ward at the hospital. She had got her nursing degree by that time. Eventually, he was given a medical retirement from the Army and transferred to the Spinal Cord Injury Center at Long Beach, California, to learn to live in a wheelchair. I thought I was pretty badly injured, but there were so many at Long Beach worse off than me. I began to feel fortunate, says Chuck. I realized some were never going to live outside a hospital. They, the patients, were at all stages of recovery. And I saw people in wheelchairs could do things, he says. From there on, I had an open vision toward it, the wheelchair. Wilcox graduated from Multnomah Community College with a 2-year degree in automotive engineering before he was drafted in 1967. And I couldn't remember whether he was drafted or whether he signed up to go. So it's good to read newspapers. They're not always real accurate, but I think this one, because he helped write it. I mean, you know, he gave the writer the information. But after he returned, he knew he would not be going to the fields to fix farm machinery. He changed his emphasis to agribusiness at Oregon State University. And I need to tell you about his schooling at Oregon State. One of my younger brothers, Jim, also was going to Oregon State University and lived with them, with Chuck and Pam, in Corvallis, and helped Chuck, along with a lot of friends, go up and down the steps in the buildings at Oregon State, because there were no escalators, or in some of the buildings there weren't even elevators. Mm-hmm. And it took, you know, a village to get Chuck up and down the steps in the buildings at Oregon State. But of course, nobody minded doing that, but it took some thinking and some planning ahead for Chuck to get to the classes. So it was just one more thing. Of course, my brother Jim helped with bringing in the wood and doing things like that that Chuck hadn't figured out yet how to do on his own in a wheelchair. So, and at that time, while Chuck was still in college, they adopted their first son too. So it was a busy household. On campus, there were a lot of vets, young, new vets on the radical side, says Wilcox. There were very little anti-war, and there were plenty of hippie types. But Wilcox ignored the radical veterans and went about learning a trade. For more than 12 years, he worked at the Fountain Grain Growers Fertilizer Department in Hermiston. Few of his co-workers have heard his story. In addition, he has a 30-acre farm on East Walls Road, where they still live, where he runs 35 head of cows and a few pigs. They no longer have animals. I try to do everything except maybe ride horses and dance, and that was the two things that he really misses, is riding horses. Because he rode all of his life, he loved to ride horses. I can do almost anything. It just takes more pre-planning. He hasn't had to figure out a way to get on a tractor. His wife loves outside work, and his two sons, Tim at the time, 16, and Toby, 10, do most of the labor. I'm what you might call a supervisor. Wilcox is a member of the Oregon chapter of the National Paralyzed Veterans Association and the Disabled American Veterans, but he doesn't belong to any veteran service organizations. He didn't attend the dedication of the new Vietnam Veterans Memorial at McKenzie Park last summer. The memorial is really fine, says Wilcox. I don't think there is any way you can be compensated for this type of a loss, but the benefits make it easier to get along in life. The Veterans Administration is doing its best to help make your life normal as possible, but everybody's got to make it on their own. I felt Vietnam was a useless cause, and I feel it even more so now, says Wilcox. And I like this statement. If politicians were sent over first, there wouldn't be any wars. Wilcox spends, I mean, that's even true today. Wilcox spends his free time hunting and fishing with his sons or watching their swim meets. I'm busy with other things, he says. I'm not bitter. I'm just not a crusader. So anyway, here's a picture of him with the cup and wranglers. And he's had several jobs since. I'll let you guys look at the picture of him. And he still has a handlebar mustache. He came up missing half of it one evening and didn't notice until the next morning after one of his sisters-in-law cut half of it off and fell asleep in his chair. A lot of us are jokesters in our family. But he worked for the Umatilla County Water Department, the Irrigation Department in Hermiston for several years and tried to retire when he was, I believe, 63, and they forced him out of retirement and wouldn't let him retire. He was so valuable to them. And he worked until he was just about a year ago, and they still call him back in every once in a while. He's 2.5 years older than I am, and he's still very active. He still belongs to a four-wheeler club. They go to Colorado every year to four-wheel. They have a big motor home. They travel all over the United States. He's active in the FFA alumni over there, the Hermiston Fair. They're active in that. There's really nothing they can't do. My husband and I go to PBR with him every year, spend the whole PBR with him down there. We drive down. Chuck does most of the driving, especially when we get to the city. The first few years we went to PBR with him, we'd never traveled or gone to the city with him before. I told him, I says, hey, we need to travel with you more often, because at that time, people in wheelchairs always got to the front of the line in a buffet line. And you know, at that time, buffets were really a good buy, so we ate at the buffets a lot. And when he went with Chuck and Pam, we always, oh, you know, come to the front of the line, you know. And we never minded that a bit, because we could always get every girl on time, because we had to go to the front of the line to eat. And anywhere there was an escalator, Chuck would just scare everybody else in the whole place to death, because the escalators would be full, and Chuck would ride the escalators in his wheelchair. Have you ever seen anybody ride an escalator in a wheelchair? Well, neither did anybody else. And especially people at the bottom of the escalator, if they see somebody coming down the escalator in a wheelchair, they scatter. I mean, it's just hysterical. But he rides them backwards, and because he can hang on both sides, you know, and he gets on with his chair and rides down backwards. And it's just absolutely hysterical to watch people at the bottom scatter. And it's just like, oh, somebody's hollered fire, you know. But he has, you know, really a fun sense of humor about things like that, because he kind of thinks it's funny too to watch. But he's not let anything stop him. He's got a wonderful feeling about going forward and not being bitter about what happened to him in Vietnam. He he's made it easier for his family and for his friends to not look at it as a disability, because it isn't to him. And sad, yes, but made it work. And so it's easy. So if he hadn't accepted it so readily, we wouldn't have been able to. So anyway, thank you for letting me share.
Thank you.
It's probably harder on my mom than it was me. In fact, she was a school teacher, a high school school teacher, and she wrote an article once on employers or employees, disabled people working, and she wrote about several disabled people in the county, and one of them was her son, Chuck. She didn't indicate that he was her son, but I'm sure everybody knew that. And that she said, Chuck Wilcox, the 39-year-old, who was 39 at the time, who is a paraplegic, certainly has not let his disability interfere in his living a full and productive life. His persistence since becoming disabled has motivated him to become entirely independent. He is married, the father of two boys, and manager of a fertilizer department. His hobbies include hunting, fishing, and camping, and he is also an active member of the Full Green Club. His innovative ideas and perseverance has made these activities possible. He can do everything. Beat his mother. So, anyway. And that's the thing. She said that people with disabilities are accomplishing much through their own determination and persistence in achieving their goals. Not only are they contributing to their own well-being, but they are motivating those who are non-disabled by making them realize that anything can be accomplished through believing in oneself, and by having determination and fortitude, anyone can obtain his goals in life. So, anyway, thank you.
Thank you.
Can I ask a question?
Okay.
Because the articles in the paper in 69 said that it was friendly fire.
It was friendly fire. Those guys had been out for 24 hours, 24/7 for several days. They had no sleep. And it was probably, could have been one of his own members of his own platoon that shot him. They were just, you know, they were just rummy from no sleep. And he realized that. He realized it. They were all in foxholes, being shot at all the time, you know, for 24 hours, for several days in a row. And, especially from, they figured it out because of from where the bullets came from, and the entry wounds, that it probably was friendly fire. You can't be bitter about something like that. I mean, he was a victim of circumstance. So, and a lot of that happened.
So it was probably in M16 and not in 1847.
I don't know.
That would have been 1847.
In any case, I don't know. Soviet.
Well, it was common. I first noticed that 2 weeks into my tour over there that it was common for a lot of combatants to carry AK-47s because they were more reliable than the U.S.-issued M16 until about the middle of 1969. And that was when the U.S. issued the remodeled multiple times remodeled. But anyway, they reissued a better version of the M16. And I knew people who were true believers in the AK and would not carry an M16 because they had such bad experiences with it.
Well, my brother, February when I went up to Mattigan to visit him. I know it was February. And so that's of 69.
Yeah, so that would fit.
So,
well,
thank you, Nancy.
You're welcome. Sorry for being no
that
baby.
Was hard.
these are the letters from my grandfather to my grandmother in 1918. He was in England, she was in Oklahoma. She had three kids and she delivered one while he was gone. He didn't know she had a baby until what the sex was until a month later. My Aunt Mildred has always read these letters and went, oh, he really wanted to pull me. Because he kept referring to a boy. These are letters from my father to my mother in World War II. He was in Alabama in 43 when my sister Mary was born, and he didn't see her until 14 days later, which was not too bad. Then came my sister Sue in 1945, January of 1945. My father was in France. He did not get home until December of 1945. She was almost a year old. And the same thing. Here's the letter. Oh, Junior. Well, Junior was a girl. So there was a little backtracking. These are letters from Steve to me in 1973-74. He was in the Navy. He didn't have a baby to worry about. And then the next one is 2011. My son-in-law was in the Air Force in Afghanistan. And this little baby arrived. But as you see, there's a little bit of a difference. He knew exactly when the baby was born because of the way things have changed, technology. So here are the two of them sleeping together for the first couple of hours. But, I mean, this is great, but there will be no more letters to have this. There will be no more letters to look back on, because this was all done Skyping. There were no letters. There were no emails. So that's something that's changed in how the war's going. So someone else would like to share. But I found with these letters and reading them, and I've read, my parents wrote, everybody wrote every other day, or every day. And just in the letters, there's the theme throughout the letters, there was the trust issue, because the mail wouldn't arrive. I haven't gotten a letter from you for weeks or months. Are you still there? Are you still, you know, am I still in the picture? You know, what's going on? And the sharing and celebrating these events in their lives. You know, that was something that was taken away. Now it's instantaneous, and I'm not sure that that's a good thing, because, you know, you might be having a bad day and go, you know, on your phone. So, I don't know. But someone else, a daughter, a wife.
Are you going to talk a little bit about what you were doing in those years? It kind of follows on some of the agencies.
Well, I was graduating from high school in 65, went into nursing school. I had several friends from my high school that were given the choice of jail or Vietnam, so I chose Vietnam. And in 69, I had already graduated from nursing school. I worked in the surgical emergency room at the large county hospital in Atlanta. And my experience there was we were getting the physicians that had, the residents who had served in Vietnam were coming back to the hospital, coming back into residency programs. Totally changed because in trauma centers, we didn't have those in the 60s. That came out, I mean, they started coming out after the war. And these guys would come back and just do things in the emergency rooms that we were not allowed to do because they've done it in the field hospital. It was like, no, we're not going to the operating room. We're going to crack this chest right here, and we nurses would get in trouble because you weren't allowed to do that in the emergency room. But anyway, these guys were coming back, and then it became the rise of the physician assistant because of the corps, all of the medics coming back. So that came out. This is all evolving in the 60s era, and I had a brother-in-law in Vietnam, and my sister, the one who'd been seeing her father for a year, actually miscarried in the same hospital that she was born in, and her husband was in Vietnam at that time. Steve and I were together at the end of the war in 73, 74, 79, and the same thing. I was a nurse at home, letters back and forth. We were not married at the time. That kind of even is a little bit more scary when you don't hear. He didn't hear from me, and I didn't hear from him what's going on. But that same, you know, we keep sending people off to war. And now with what's come out recently about that this could have all possibly, really possibly been stopped in 68, is just almost unbearable for those of us who knew people who went. And so that's all. It's just my story. So who else? Judy.
I have two fast stories. One is about Robert Carr. And I'm gonna cry. When I was a little girl in grade school, Robert Carr used to call me a bag of bones. And I hated him. I hated that Robert Carr. And then in high school, Robert Carr heard somebody else call me a bag of bones. And he said, "Nobody's allowed to call her that, only me." And then I knew Robert Carr maybe felt something different. He was the first high school boy from my high school. I graduated in 65 to die in Vietnam. And I always remembered him. So I went off to college, this is my second fast story. And when I was ready to graduate in 69, I have three brothers right after me. And then I have a little brother who and they got numbers, and I was upset. And as a woman, I thought, I can either get married to Don Morrison and go to Florida and go to graduate school, or I can listen to President Kennedy and join the Peace Corps, because women didn't fight. And I will have to say, honestly, I don't know why men want to fight. So when I was reading that, and that's why I joined the Peace Corps, and later met Rich, but Vietnam has been in my mind, is all I'm saying. It's just there. That war was a life changer for me and many people. That's all.
Thank you,
Jim.
Thank you.
Thank you.
I'm not going to stand up front because I was one of those late 60s babies. I was born in 67. My dad called me his little draft dodge. Mm. So that tells you a lot about his politics. Dad went to graduate school, and when he found out my mom was pregnant, he realized he didn't need to stay in graduate school. So here I am. My mom and dad are no longer married, and I think some of that may have been a part of it. But Vietnam, for me, I was thinking as you were all talking about the time, you know, we have kids now that are in high school who were babies when 9/11 hit. And their perspective of what that meant is very similar to what I experienced about Vietnam. When I was in high school, it was only been 14 or 15 years after the war ended, when I graduated from high school. went to and didn't talk about, or your parents didn't go to and didn't talk about, and it was too close historically for there to be a real analysis in history books. So you got the dates of the Tet Offensive, and you got the, you know, the big things, but you didn't get any perspective. And so it's been interesting for me now to hear all of your stories and to think back on how it impacted my family, because my mother's husband, who just passed a few weeks ago, was a Vietnam vet and was a POW. And it impacted his life in so many ways, and it ultimately killed him due to his exposure to Agent Orange. But to think that any of us, whether we're, you know, my family, we think we're so removed from all of those war experiences, all of us are touched by it. You know, without them, we wouldn't be here. So it's a, it just kind of struck me listening. So thank you for all of us. Thank you for being together.
You mentioned, and I actually talked to Mary Swanson about coming, and I was hoping she'd make it. But Tom, of course, was exposed to Agent Orange heavily, Tom Swanson. And I remember when they came up here and bought the bookstore from us, they were trying to get the VA to pay for genetic testing because they were fearful of birth defects because of the Agent Orange. And that time, the military was not admitting that there was any impact of Agent Orange. So, you know, there's another little story. But I also remember days from the bookstore, and at one time I thought, you know, I should write it. There should be a portrait of the Vietnam refugees in Wallowa County. Skip, the one famous one now is Skip Royce, because Pam wrote about that, and Skip ran away to Wallowa after being in Vietnam, and then, as he said, somebody told him in Eugene he better get somewhere else, or he was going to kill himself over there, trying to keep up with the college drinking and drug using crowd. And so he came to Minnehaha, where, Nancy, you'll have to help me there, it's Sam Loftus's daughter,
okay,
married Tim Strong.
Yes.
And he was in the service with Skip, yeah. And he was killed. Pardon?
And
Tim was killed in Vietnam. But we also had John Renau, who would sit in the back of the bookstore, and he was writing a physics textbook. And he graduated in physics from Notre Dame.
Didn't he fix Volkswagens?
When he came back from Vietnam, he made his way as a tree planter. And eventually he married June and made a daughter, Dave. But he would sit back in the back of the bookstore, and he was working on this. He was trying to pick up his old self, you know, and that never got picked up. I was trying to remember some of the other ones, but there have just been so many people here for whom this was coming here or coming back here was some kind of a refuge and some kind of an attempt to gain some kind of normalcy in their lives. But it certainly changed them. Changed the complexion of everything here. I think there were, for years, there was the Chief Joseph Summer Camp, the day camp, and I think some of the instructors, Barney, am I right, one year marched in the Chief Joseph Day's parade with some anti-war stuff, and that created a fervor. Sure. Barney's dad and mom were instrumental in that thing. So I don't know, in little ways and big ways, that war is really impacted us. And as I said, there's the piece over there. One of the interesting things, this kid that goes to Vietnam out of Logging Town, Oregon, and Yale, at the end of, or somewhere in his article, he wrote in the halls at Yale, there are the names of hundreds of Yalies who died in World War I and World War II. There are the names of 35 Yalies who died in Vietnam, none since. And so our military, we're still making wars, but, and he said, war, we don't have volunteers now. He said, I call them the recruited. volunteers were the people who after Pearl Harbor ran down to volunteer. If you look at the, it would be interesting to compare the chieftains from 1943 and 1969. Mm-hmm. In 1942, 43, and I went through them when we did a World War II thing here. There was a row of people every week in the chieftain. Here are the boys off for induction. Here are the boys off to, and it was all, you know, and even Gwen Coffin, who hated war.
He still honored the soldiers.
He honored the soldiers.
And that's the same with Vietnam. He did the same thing.
But that, and he basically was anti, he wasn't all anti-war in the Second World War. He saw the evil of Hitler and all of that. But he also wrote about the war profiteers, the guys making a buck off the war, which really pissed Gwen Coffin off worse than the...
And the incarceration of the Japanese, which he was against.
And he wrote, and I've got a copy of that, by the way, Gwen Coffin wrote an editorial saying that the internment of the Japanese would not be a shining moment in our history. We would not look on it as such.
And he got really ostracized.
Yeah. Barbara wouldn't cut his hair. He told me. So anyway, I think this stuff rumbles around and goes on, like Angie said. It doesn't stop.
Can I ask a question to those of you that spouses and family members who are in the war? How did you talk to your kids about your experiences? Was that something that they were interested in, or did you ever have stories that you passed on, or was that something that was, in my family, it was done, it would happen, we don't need to talk about it at the end of it, so I was curious about how your experiences with your own children.
Well, I know that my father from World War II never said a word until Steve, who was Jewish, and my father got out his book and said, whatever, because he was at that time. And that was it. We always thought maybe it was because we were girls, but I don't know if that was it. My brother-in-law has never spoken.
Did you talk to your kids, Walter?
My dad didn't talk about his tour to North Africa or his tour to France, Germany, England, and France. My daughters were very curious about what I did in Vietnam, and I had a struggle with myself for almost 10 years about how to do that, how to handle that appropriately for them, because I knew if I told them the raw stories, it was going to be so devastating, they may never recover. But I also knew they had to know. I knew I wasn't going to get away the way my dad got away by just refusing to talk. So I promised them that when they got into high school, I would talk with them about it as much as they wanted me to talk with them about it. And as soon as they were done, I would be done. And I honored that. We had dinner together every night. Every night they were with me. And as it happened, my nephew, who was in the Marine Corps, came to our house for dinner the night my oldest daughter started high school. And my youngest daughter, just sharp memory as you've ever seen, she said, "Dad, you're supposed to talk about Vietnam." I mean, I haven't picked up my fork yet, And my nephew, who was, he's still a big boy, he was in the Marine Corps, and he had done about a year of training at that point. He said, "Oh, this is going to be good." And my oldest daughter said, "Maybe not." Mm-hmm. And that started it. That started the conversation. And yes, I talked with them a little bit. I tried to give them a big picture view in the sense of, here I was, this kid in high school in the Carolinas, and the draft came along, and I tried to go to college, and all I can see in college that was interesting were all these girls' legs, and good Lord, there were like 15,000 pairs of them. How in the world was I going to study biology, and I never did study biology. Anyway,
his legs.
I got my draft. staff noticed, and I thought, okay, those girls will start noticing me now because I'll have a uniform. Boy, was I wrong. When I came back, they said, oh, well. But anyway, I did talk with my daughters about it a little bit, and my youngest daughter, it seemed, was the most curious about the nitty-gritty stuff. She wanted to know, she was not yet in high school, she was in sixth grade, and she wanted to know, did I kill anybody? And that was hard for me because I could, it was so complicated. My job was calling airstrikes. My job included calling airstrikes. And the Air Force gave us the title combat controllers. That was a shortened version of combat air traffic controllers. I make it a habit of reassuring people, nobody controls combat. Absolutely nobody, nowhere, no how. And anybody who's been following Obama's handling of the generals over the last 8 years knows that nobody controls combat. Anyway, the short of it is, I gave my daughters a general picture of there was fighting going on all around me. I was usually put in the middle of it, approximately, as far as that could be determined, and depending on where an aircraft would land and drop me off. And that was usually a helicopter. And so my job was to bring order to the chaos as much as was necessary to kill everybody necessary to save the good guys. That was enough for my oldest daughter. She didn't need to hear any more. My youngest daughter's imagination was fired up. My nephew's imagination was fired up because he knew he was about to go to, I forget which one it was, we're talking late 90s, Clinton years. Pardon me?
Kosovo.
He was thinking he would probably be going to Kosovo, that's right. I remember the conversation lasted for a few hours, and I remember my oldest daughter did something very uncharacteristic. She would do this sometime, but rarely. She had taken all the dishes off the table, taken them to the kitchen, and washed them, and gone to her room and did her homework. And the rest of us were still at the table talking, including my youngest daughter. So that's the short of it.
Well, and for me, the letters, I'd never read the letters from my mother and father until after both of them. My mother died early. And then after my dad died and going through his stuff and hear all this treasure trove of letters, and I mean boxes of letters. And that's how I found out all of this. Their relationship, was through these letters. Mm-hmm. And so it's a treasure for me, these letters, because it wasn't spoken about. And in the letters, it's not a lot alluded to as to what he was doing, but you kind of got a sense of this far away, ends up over there, finally figured out he could heave a rock to keep him warm.
Well, I quit putting details in the letters because those letters were destroyed before they got to my mom or my girlfriend. Mm-hmm. And so I just quit sending them. For a little while, I tried sending photographs, and then those got destroyed. And then I tried sending slides, and those got destroyed. So I just gave up.
So, Barney, your dad, you finally got your dad to talk way late in his life, right?
Yeah, I've got 6 hours of tapes.
About World War II.
Well, I had to start out, I want to take your life. Kind of work up to it. So what was your first memory, and how were your parents towards you, and so on and so forth. And then we got into the war, and we'd heard a few small stories, but not much. And he told us on those tapes, everything. I mean, I know which islands, and you know.
You're lucky to have a treasure.
Yeah. So how old was he then?
Actually,
in the 70s?
When he did that?
When he told you the story.
Probably in his 80s.
In his 80s.
Yeah, early 80s. But the one thing I remember is, because I always wondered, why won't he talk about it? Why don't they talk about it? Which is a stupid question. And I've never seen my dad cry, ever. Well, he's never cussed, he's never cried. I've never seen him drunk, he's controlled. And I said, how, and so we've gone through all the Iwo Jima, Guam, Guadalcanal, Bougainville, how he met my mom, all that stuff. And I said, why don't you ever, I had the camera rolling. And he just went dead silent and goes, yeah, and I have a hard time talking about it because he said, if you saw your best friend get killed, you wouldn't talk about it either. And then he started crying, goes, turn off the camera. Mm-hmm. I pretend like I turned it off, but I, and that was the end of 6 hours of his life. It ended right there. We didn't go on past that.
Okay. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Well, yeah.
I just want to ask this. I think it's good to talk about it or bad to talk about it. I mean, my thought is if something very powerful happens to us, we don't just walk up and go, hi, my name is Judy. Now, do you realize that when I was in Vietnam, and it's just not a chatty subject. You don't do that. And so for me, those men who carried those amazing stories and still carry them right now, I know there are people that think that too many people have post-traumatic stress and talk about it. I don't really hear that much, and I am still practicing as a therapist and go to the senior center and meet men who are in their 80s that think they are having some depression, and then when they start talking, they're talking about a war thing, and they don't really, I can understand why they don't want to talk about it. It's so powerful. So I don't even imagine, like if I know my dad kept stories, that he didn't, how could we even bring it up, I wonder. I'm just asking. I'm not surprised that people don't turn out
well,
like
my
this.
My dad used to have nightmares.
Yes.
He would wake up in the middle of the night screaming and he never said what it was, but he was World War II vet, and I imagine it stemmed from his World War II.
I had two uncles that were captured on Corrugated Arm, one on Bataan, and they were on the death march. Spent 42 months in POW camp, it was like 2,000 guys there. But they would talk about it, but it was usually something funny that it would happen.
That's right.
And they did say that the 10 death march, that was a bad deal, but they said that the ride across the China Sea and the boats, they said it was so hot that it made them march. You had to get up on the deck, but they were only let so many, so there was just a continuous circle of guys marching from the hold to the deck. And he said that if you were sick and couldn't do it, he said you would die. He said it was 135. Mm-hmm. It was so hot, but those guys, I was about 5 years old when they came home, and I remember thinking, well, those are skinny guys, those guys, they just picked up their lives right where they left off,
some did and some didn't.
Yeah.
Well, and when we did the World War II thing here, there was a fellow whose father was he was in the same deal as Jack McLaren. Jack McLaren liberated Bougainville. Jack didn't talk about it, and then later in his life he told the story, and then we finally convinced him, and he actually gave a public presentation, and we have that on tape, on audio. And Jack's reason for doing that was because of Bougainville and because of Holocaust deniers. And Alvin Josephy and probably your dad, these friends who'd been through similar experiences had something to do with it. And I remember when he gave that talk, he credited Alvin with telling him, you know what? We got to tell these stories. And so that's that's what drove Jack to tell that story.
I'm convinced that it's true. We have to tell these stories because our children and grandchildren need these stories, because our friends need these stories. But I also am convinced from listening to hundreds, maybe thousands of Vietnam combat veterans across the range of activities in Vietnam that we need all the help we can get telling these stories, because we tend to mix up the details. I catch myself mixing up the details. I just caught myself after saying that in the middle of 1969, the U.S. military introduced the remodel in 16. That was in the middle of 1968. I came home in 1969. I came home in February, and I remember my brother Keith, who had just come back from the DMZ in Korea, picked me up at the airport in Columbia, South Carolina, and we promptly went and drank the four bottles of booze that I had in my bag, brought back to Vietnam. We could bring back a gallon, you know. So I brought back a gallon of booze. It was all American booze, but, you know, over there it was like $5 a bottle. Anyway.
What a deal.
Keith and I got to Mom and Dad's house and they lived in a house I'd never seen before because they moved while I was in Vietnam. Anyway, we got to their house and stumbled around, found our way inside. Keith says, we're going to sleep in here. We go in there and go to bed and go to sleep. And next thing I know, I got to go to the bathroom. I get up and I walk through, I see this light on. See the light coming under the door. I walked to where that light is, and my dad is sitting in there in a rocking chair by a lamp reading the Bible. And I looked at him and I said, what are you doing? And he looked up at me and he said, well, we've been in there screaming for 2 hours. I don't know how anybody in this house can sleep. And I said, I've been sleeping like a baby. He said, no, you haven't. I said, I got to go to the bathroom. I went to the bathroom. When I came back from the bathroom, he was still sitting there. He said, son, you'll be having those nightmares when you die. And that was almost the end of our conversation, my conversation with him about Vietnam. I had a couple more conversations with him, but not very much. That was in 69. In 1977, it was pretty clear that my dad was losing his mind to Alzheimer's. I decided I would drop out of school for the summer. I was going through school full blast at that point. I had that. That's another issue. Yes, it was profoundly connected with Vietnam. I'd have never gone back to college if I hadn't gone to Vietnam. But anyway, I got to South Carolina, where my intention was to spend as much that summer as I could with Mom and Dad. Particularly, I wanted to have my man-to-man conversation with Dad about why these wars are going on, why was I so determined to go to that war, and why didn't he do anything to stop me? I had already reminded myself that before I went to Vietnam, I said to my dad, I'm not sure if I'm doing the right thing, but I can't think of anything more right. And my dad said to me then, we're talking 1967, he said, well, son, it probably won't hurt you. It might do you some good.
Oh, jeez.
And he genuinely meant it. But there's another little detail I want to bring in here, because while I was in Vietnam, I'd only been over there a couple of weeks, and I was involved in a pretty nasty operation, and I found out the Air Force had, my superiors had put me in for a certain medal, and I was just astonished, because where I was, there were Marines dying every minute, and all we were doing was trying to bring order to that chaos. Anyway, I wrote my dad a letter and I said, Dad, if anybody gets a medal, it should be those Marines. I don't deserve that medal. Those Marines are the ones who should be getting those medals. And my dad wrote me back. And it's hard for me to say this, but it's true. He said, son, for what you're doing over there, if they give you the White House, take it, because it's not good enough. And I pondered that for years and years and years, and it finally made sense in connection with something else, which was the only thing he would tell us in our childhood about why he went to, or what he did when he was in the war. Because we were looking at the scars on his arms and on his legs, and where he got shot up. And the only thing he would say was, I got caught trying to steal a chicken. And I did not put that together with what he wrote to me in Vietnam until his funeral. The man who he served with in Europe, his immediate superior in Europe, my dad was a tank commander in Europe, and his immediate commander was a fellow named Jerry Dupree. Jerry Dupree gave a brief talk, and we boys had specifically asked Jerry Dupree, we called him Uncle Jerry because he was Dad's best friend. He was one of Dad's two best friends. The other one was from North Africa, from the North Africa campaign. And Jerry Dupree specifically told the story about when my dad got shot in France. And the story included the little detail that every time my dad would try to stand up after he got blown, his tank got blown up, and he was laying on the ground. He was the only fellow out of that tank who was still alive. And he would try to stand up and run, but he didn't know he couldn't run because his leg was broken, and he would hit the ground and start flopping. And Jerry Dupree told this story, and he said every time your dad tried to stand up, the Germans would start shooting at him with their automatic rifle, and there was a rooster out there in that field that would start crowing. And when they finally got to my dad to pull him back, because there was no way he could move by himself, that rooster was still out there. And Jerry Dupree said, your dad was trying to catch that rooster because he was hungry. Hmm. Now, we try to put those details together, and they don't really go together. I mean, come on, you know, there's a lot of stuff that doesn't make sense from the details of our life. However, it was a way my dad could put the world together in his mind, in all those experiences and stories that were going together in his mind. He got caught trying to steal a chicken. He made a dumb mistake going into the war, like I made a dumb mistake. We kids always make dumb mistakes. That's what it's about, being a kid. That's one of the reasons parents love us enough to let us go and make dumb mistakes. We learn from our dumb mistakes. Okay.
Well, and I think that that's in the book. That's what he talks about. You were saying, you know, you were getting your details mixed up. But I think that that's, yeah.
You mean in Tim O'Brien's book?
In Tim O'Brien's
book. Oh, yeah, yeah, yeah. Tim O'Brien handles that magnificently.
You know, it is that you remember, but yet you don't remember. That's like I went back and read the letters from Steve that he wrote to me.
Yeah.
And it's like, oh, I've forgotten all about that. I've gotten, you know,
right,
those details. And you ask him, he's never talked about his service with his daughters.
Right.
So, you know, maybe it is. You talk to your daughters, but. And your brother probably talked to his son.
I was going to ask you that, Nancy. Has he talked to his kids?
I don't know whether he has or not.
Be interesting to.
Yeah.
Interesting to find out.
There was about just over a month ago, this American Life did a program. You know what I'm talking about an Afghan an officer, and talking about coming back, and this guy has this tremendous sense of humor and everybody loves him, but at some point it broke. And he talks about, it's really worth a listen, if I can find it, I'll post a link for you, but it's the punchline was basically he didn't talk about it because he didn't want to traumatize the people in his life. He didn't want to hurt them. He didn't want them to feel what they would feel to see the looks on their faces when he told them what was really happening. So it was an interesting moment. It's worth a listen if you're.
Well, and that's what Tim O'Brien did. His daughter.
Did I want to hurt you. Yeah.
She didn't want to be part of it.
Yeah.
Danny, why don't you write about something happy?
But do we think that this is good that now almost 50 years later this year, that there is a conversation going on in Wallowa County about this? Being on the Big Read Committee, it was like, do we do this? Do we not do this? We knew it was going to be tears. We knew it was going to bring out things that people might want to continue to suppress. But have we done a good thing by doing this? I mean, I'm just curious because, you know, it's
well,
county.
I can, again, from that essay, I'll tell you one reason we should. If he's right, and I think that, you know, with the, that war has now become the thing that the Trump supporters participate in, and that people that go to college don't participate in, and it's divided our country. And so, if and he says at the end of his essay, and sometime this split is going to be realized, and it's going to be dangerous.
And here it is.
And it might be that here it is right now. And Vietnam is probably, 35 Yalies are killed in Vietnam. Vietnam is the last time that probably there was a congressional son or daughter or member, you know, of Congress. There are no members of Congress who have anybody in the military now that I know of.
Biden.
But that's right. Yeah.
Who is that?
Biden.
Joe Biden. Yeah, Joe Biden did. Yeah.
I mean, I'm just, to answer your question, I don't think it's a wonderful topic. The book is fabulous. But people are only going to participate who feel able to. I think it's just how we are as humans. It's not a right thing that we read the book or a wrong thing.
I'm just saying, has this been good for the people who are here?
What I see is a huge difference, according to the book, was, Rich, your point about how picture after picture in the chieftain of the people lining up to join World War II because they understood their reason. And they wanted to go and serve their country, and they didn't even need to be drafted. They volunteered because they wanted to be
observed. A lot of them weren't drafted, though.
Okay, thank you. But the pictures of them going had more meaning for, at least in my mind, the whole United States. I never understood the Vietnam War. I could not get a picture of what is this about. And I'm still asking that question. And
so
I get answers.
So are the people that went.
Yes, yeah. Exactly.
My brother is
and it's in
yeah.
the book.
No, his remark in that.
Excellent.
He doesn't know why he was there.
Excellent.
Read David Hammerstein's The Best and the Brightest, and he'll answer all your questions.
No, I haven't.
Well, and then we've got, you know, that's the question of Afghanistan and the Persian Gulf. And,
sure.
Yeah,
you know,
and
Iraq.
I can't figure out why we're over in the Middle East.
At least there's oil there, Barry.
There
Go over there and blow up their countries and then rebuild them.
Then there's the That's
the war machinery. The economics of war. What keeps it going. Essentially, you can't stop it because the economy is based upon it. I mean, you look at different, you know, different corporations. Halliburton.
Yeah.
Okay. I mean, they couldn't survive without war.
Or
even Boeing, or even Lockheed Martin.
Look
at all of
that. And Rich, I don't think it's the Trump supporters that are in favor of war. It's somebody a little.
No. I said the Trump supporters are participating.
They're the ones that
They're the ones that are participating in the war.
No, but you know how the children, the young men and women are recruited now. The recruiters go to the poorest schools. They don't go to the you know,
to the Ivy League.
No, the high schools. I'm talking high schools. They go to the poor neighborhoods, the third world people, the people of color, those kinds of people, and they recruit. And the schools allow this. They allow the recruiters to come in. Like, I had my granddaughter living with me in Portland her last 2 years of high school at Cleveland High School. And she was taking college prep, but she hadn't really designated a school, college she was going to go to. So she got these recruiters calling all the time. The schools give out the phone numbers. They call them at home, call them and bombard them. The kids that think, well, they don't have any other recourse. You know, they're not college bound. The way the economy is, the way the job situation is, well, what else am I going to do? And then they make them all these false promises, too, about, oh, then we're going to educate you, we're going to train you, blah, 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 which when the reality, it just falls flat. It doesn't happen. My granddaughter's boyfriend, he was debating, like, whether to go, and I, don't you dare go, you know, and I told my sons, don't you dare go. My father was a career officer, and I was brought up with that. And I was telling the story to Angie when I was maybe, four, maybe five. He was in World War II. He had a pretty exclusive situation. He was a supply officer for a bomber squadron, so he did office work in China somewhere and actually made a lot of money and came out of it very well. But when he came to my grandparents knocking on the door, and I went to open it, I just looked at him. He had his uniform, maybe a duffel bag or something, and I just looked at him. I didn't know who he was. I hadn't seen him. He was rarely in my life. And then he went back, and then we lived together in Santa Barbara for a while, and he started some businesses there. And then he got recalled in the Korean War. He was in the First Army Air Force and then the Air Force when they branched off as a separate. And he went to Japan, and he would get, because he was an officer, he would fly into Korea like once a month, and he would get flight pay or combat pay, you know, for being landing in Korea. Once he would do that. So I heard that story. But, you know, I think his involvement, that he didn't have a lot of these really horror war stories to tell, and he pretty much just did carry on his life when he came back. But I just grew up feeling I really didn't have much of a father, didn't really know him. He was like a stranger.
When I was in Vietnam, and after I came back, it was verified. The U.S. Air Force told us, I was in the Air Force, the U.S. Air Force told everybody in the Air Force who paid attention at all, 5% of U.S. Air Force personnel participated in combat. That included the air crews that flew into combat. It included people like myself who were on the ground in combat, not very many of us, but a few of us. And it included the paramedics and the rescue operators, helicopter crews. Okay, so 5%, think about that. 95 out of 100 people in the Air Force hardly ever heard of ground fire, hardly ever heard of a mortar explosion or a rocket explosion. And that 5% included the people who were at places like Cameron Bay and Tanzanut that got attacked by rockets. Da Nang, that got attacked by rockets. 5%.
I think the one thing that everybody, all males who are between the ages of 18 and 23, will remember their draft number.
Yep.
Everybody remembers their draft.
27.
Yes.
I was 14.
72.
Wow.
But everybody remembers their number, because that was a major thing, a major transition when they stopped the draft. And you know, if you were 250 or 300, there was no reason to go to college anymore.
That's right.
There was no reason to get married. There was no reason to have a child. The idea is, you know, there was no reason to run from anything. You had that low number.
Well, in those days, if you were married with a kid, you didn't have to go, and that's your little drop off.
That's
way changed.
Top that big thing.
Even now I know you come from a culture that was inspired by the one
Steve,
I came from.
You were talking about, you know, Eisenhower's military-industrial complex. Why is there so little discussion today of the arms we sell to Saudi Arabia to carry on the war in Yemen? I mean, there's almost no discussion of that. And it's a...
And then those arms that are sold to our sort of friends now then go to people eventually who aren't our friends, and you can fire back at our troops. What I see is, on the newsreels, I see when ISIS rolls into town, they've got our Humvees, our Wallowas, because we sent it to Iraq, and those guys, as soon as they saw them coming, they threw them down and ran the other way. But you cannot have a war if you don't arm both sides.
Yeah.
I think so that's part of the plan.
That's a simple.
That's been the Rothschild secret of success for 300 years.
What's the George Bernard Shaw? Major Barbara?